Hello, everybody, and welcome to another live stream featuring both myself and my lovely girlfriend, Melissa Kelly. Yay. Melissa Kelly, how's it going?
I'm good.
Shall I just strictly refer to you as Melissa Kelly for the whole evening?
Yes, in fact, if you don't, I'm going to stab you under the table where no one can see.
Threats of violence, fantastic. Yeah. That's
straight out of the gate.
That's my channel banned.
Oh, no, really?
No, I'm sure it will be fine. So, I mean, you know, an insight into our relationship. I just call you Melissa Kelly all the time anyway, don't I? So,
yeah.
Or if I'm feeling sarcastic, Melissa Kelly.
Thanks for that.
Yeah.
I mean, I really only call you Levi Clay when you're being outrageous and ridiculous, so most of the time.
Which is why I call you Melissa Kelly all the time, because you're always being outrageous and ridiculous. Anyway, today, obviously, I've kind of talked about this. I've alluded to this on the Guitar Souls podcast, that I am planning on and working on a podcast concept with Melissa. We have a name for it. It's going to be called Does Metal Have Soul? Which is, that's going to be a lot of fun. And we are going to listen to, we're going to go through the history of metal, heavy metal music. Because Melissa, being an old school soul girl and jazz girl, has no real concept of rock and metal. It's not an area of expertise. So we're going to listen to all of that. And of course, Melissa has a master's degree in songwriting. So she's extremely qualified in our field to talk about music, and it'll be interesting to see how that school of thought can be applied to something far removed from your field of expertise. And of course, I'm sure you guys will all enjoy that. We will have fun doing that. That is going to happen. But also at the same time, we've been toying with the idea of doing some videos talking about some of the things that Melissa grew up listening to, some of the things that Melissa loves and enjoys. Now, generally speaking, I am going to put some of those, I'm going to say behind a paywall and sound like an asshole, I'm going to put some of those things behind a paywall on Patreon, because I don't want them to take over the channel. But when I did, we did the Periphery stream,
mm-hmm.
A couple of people listened to that, and despite not liking Periphery or really liking that sound, they learned a lot from it, and they listened to the whole record with us, and they've listened to the record since because they tried to learn more about the genre.
Mm-hmm.
And I had students say to me that they would love for us to do something similar with jazz music, because they sit and try and listen to jazz because they feel that they should. They feel mm-hmm. that they have to listen to jazz mm-hmm. because I talk about jazz. So they're like, oh, I guess I should go and take my damn medicine type thing. And they say to me, you know, I don't understand it. I don't really understand what I'm listening to. And there's always this incorrect assumption. Shut up, arsehole. This incorrect assumption that you need to be an intellectual to listen to jazz. And yeah. Obviously it's just not the case, is it?
No. No, a lot of people, I think the issue as well is that when a lot of people are told, you know, you must listen to jazz, you can only be a fully rounded musician and master of your instrument if you are understand forms of jazz. And then, of course, people go and they look at jazz and they're looking at a lot of things like sort of really chaotic bebop and going, this is hell on earth and I never want to return to it. And I can completely understand why people would go and listen to that and go, yeah, this is too much. This is exhausting to listen to, so I'm going to switch off. I do get that.
Sure. And I kind of enjoy that you mentioned stuff that would turn you off, like the bebop stuff, right? Because that's really, really funny. We're getting a request here. Andre would like you to do a dab, please. Can you do a wee dab for Andre?
What? Why?
Shame on you, madame. Being bullied by these people. Oh, so chat's not displaying over here, so I'm going to have to monitor the chat over here as well.
Oh, no.
This has nothing to do with the history of jazz. You seem nice, though. Peace out. I mean, it will have a lot to do with jazz. Don't worry about that. So you mentioned the bebop thing. And, like, obviously, because I am a musician, I don't want to describe myself as a virtuoso. It's very arrogant to call yourself a virtuoso, but I have always been into the idea of playing my instrument to a high level, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the bebop thing has always appealed to me.
Mm-hmm.
And growing up, I was listening to a lot of bebop. I was listening to a lot of hard bop. I guess you put something like Giant Steps in, like Coltrane's Giant Steps in, like that hard bop type thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely pre-modal jazz, of course. And we were talking about functional harmony earlier. Like, I'm really into that. Functional harmony, people playing melodies over fast chord changes, functional chord changes.
Mm-hmm.
I really love that. But of course, that's not how jazz was born. Jazz mm-hmm. came out of the blues, and jazz came out of, you know, like stride and boogie woogie and things like this, mm-hmm. That were music, was a American song form for singing to, dancing to. It was relaxed music. So people get this strange idea that jazz isn't that anymore.
Yeah.
And of course, I I think that jazz isn't really that anymore.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that it can't be that. Mm-hmm. You can still listen to and appreciate that stuff. You don't need a degree in music in order to listen to, appreciate and understand jazz.
No.
You maybe need a degree in music if you want to listen to, understand and appreciate jazz and be able to talk about, you know, what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't need to understand it in order to enjoy it. In the same way that you don't need to be a musician to enjoy Meshuggah or mm-hmm. or Periphery or whatever it happens to be. So we are going to take a laid-back look at jazz today, and we're going to start with one of the early pioneers of the of improvisation, melodies and things like that. One of the early names that people associate with the development of jazz coming out of the Dixieland sound, and that's Mr. Sidney Bechet.
Mm.
You love Sidney Bechet, right?
I do, yeah. It was one of those things where, as a singer, we're definitely in the same boat as far as a lot of people will say, well, you know, you need to listen to jazz in order to be a really fantastic singer, and the best singers are jazz singers. So when I was sort of doing what I did when I was learning, which was to go and mimic singers and mimic what they did and mimic things like their phrasing and their intonation and all the rest of it, you know, Ella Fitzgerald was one of those ones that's held up to singers as, like, you know, the pinnacle of the best intonation that you can have,
sure.
the best flexibility and ability to jump between intervals and all that kind of thing. So, you know, listening to Ella Fitzgerald, you know, one of the things that Ella does is she'll mimic instruments, and she mimicked a lot of instruments from then, you know, most famously with, like, Satchmo and all the kind of things that they did together. And so when I went to go and look at jazz, I found it a tricky thing because I was turned off by a lot of it to begin with because I didn't understand what was going on. I couldn't connect with it at all. And a bit like what you were talking about with functional harmony, I really need to feel that there's a melody going on, that there's an expression of, you know, playing to the song rather than trying to prove how incredibly talented you are and how very much you know the harmony.
Also known as the good stuff. Carry on.
Sure. But I was sort of looking for people to imitate, and you know, Satchmo's a great example of all that, but I kind of, again, I found it sort of trumpet a very, very hard instrument to try and replicate and think about when you're thinking about being a singer and you're improvising. And it was actually an old record that I found in the jazz section in a tiny little second-hand record store in Glasgow, the St. Merchant City. He's still there. He's a wonderful man. He's got a lovely dog in the shop. But I found Sidney Bechet, and I went away and I took a whole collection of things, but Sidney Bechet was the one that I kept coming back to. And I think it's a couple of things. I think he's playing the clarinet, which is an instrument that I can get slightly closer to as a singer to understand where he's going.
I hate the clarinet.
I know you hate the clarinet, but Sidney Bechet plays it in such a beautiful way. He's
sure.
very much playing some glorious melodies over it. And the other side of it as well is, I think, because Sidney Bechet was very much that sort of, it was New Orleans player, and the fact was a lot of the melodies and the music he was playing was very much jazz, but you can kind of hear the European influence of, like, Parisian jazz when he's playing.
Well, that happens when you play a clarinet. You just immediately hear European jazz, you know? And that I say I hate clarinet. I don't hate clarinet. It's just, to my ears, when I hear clarinet, I think European jazz. And when I hear a saxophone, I think American jazz.
Sure.
And I
do.
Like American jazz. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, yeah. And the thing is, again, when singers, I know myself, when I was trying to imitate, you know, copying a saxophone is really, really hard, and trying to be Ella's, it was really, really hard as well. But yeah, going for Sidney Bechet stuff, because the clarinet makes a more sort of round sound.
Clarinet sound like this.
No, they don't. No, they don't. No, they don't. No, I refuse the slander. Yes, brother, I agree. No, when he's talking, when like, for instance, when, you know, when Sidney Bechet does Setuve Ma Mère, he's doing this sort of beautiful rounded sound. And that was, in fact, Setuve Ma Mère was one of the first ones I started to imitate. And it was that constant hook that he went back to the whole way through. He was creating a melody, yeah. but he always returned to that. That's something else.
That's Livia Morris.
It doesn't matter. The point is, it was him doing that sort of, like, returning to a motif the whole time.
Sure.
He does it a lot, and I love the way he does it.
Yeah, now,
makes me really happy.
You know, I mentioned the bebop thing, and I'm, as I say, super, mm-hmm. super into that. But because I always describe bebop as the original punk music. And mm-hmm. I describe it as that because bebop was music written by or performed by young, rebellious musicians who had developed a great sense of ability on the instrument.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't want to keep playing the music that the old guys were playing. They wanted to go into the clubs and play music that just the young kids could play. Mm-hmm. They wanted to keep what they would describe as the moldy figs out. So they kept the moldy figs out by playing this more and more complicated music where they would up the tempos and increase the amount of chord changes, et cetera, et cetera. And it became a proving ground to show how good you were because mm-hmm. the old guys wouldn't be able to get up and do it. That, to me, is inherently anti-establishment. It's inherently mm-hmm. kind of punk in nature, which is super, super cool. But because of that, because that had such a massive influence on jazz as a whole, people forget that actually when you look to the most early jazz concepts and recordings and things, it's everything you're talking about there. It's mm-hmm. it's melody.
Yeah.
When it came to soloing, playing in a solo on your instrument, you were largely just playing the actual melody to the song, mm-hmm. but embellishing that melody.
Yeah.
So you might play the first four notes verbatim and then put a little three or four notes of ornamentation in order to connect yourself to the next part of the phrase.
Mm-hmm.
It's improvisation, but in its simplest form. Now, many people love that because, as you point out, it keeps you connected to the actual song, the actual music, the actual melody. And it's the missing thing, I think, when people start to learn to play jazz,
mm-hmm.
they ignore that.
Yeah.
They ignore the melody to the song.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, okay, well, what can I play over these changes?
Mm-hmm.
Sidney Bechet isn't that.
No.
And to me, that's really cool. So a couple of people online. Hello, Peter. How's it going? You want to hear Levi's impression of the whole Wincent? I can do that.
Ooh.
Yeah. Ooh. It's my
clarinet. Your bottom note.
I think that's an A flat today. I can't hit a G today.
It's the fact that sometimes you'll just wander around going, oh.
See how low I can go? Not very low.
Oh dear.
Yeah, anyway, so the whole wind section. I mean, all right, maybe as it goes on, maybe I'll do a little bit more of that. Hope you will, Peter. what we're going to do, just to give you an insight into Sidney and who Sidney was, probably shouldn't say is, because Sidney Bechet died in 1959, so it gives you an idea of just how old we're talking with Sidney Bechet and in terms of where his place is in the history of jazz. But before we do that, I just want to run my credits. Big thank you to my wonderful supporters over on Patreon. Couldn't keep doing these videos without your love, kindness, generosity and support. So, I mean, I guess I could, but it would be... you know, I'd be working out how the hell we were going to feed ourselves, which is awful, right? And I always joke about keeping the lights on, these lights here. I've just bought some more lights so I can backlight the room as well. So you're literally keeping the lights on by supporting the channel on Patreon. And when you have this many lights, my electricity bill is astonishing. So please do check me out in the link in the description or head on over to Amazon, check out one of my many books. I have many books available. Right, cool. So, yeah, we are going to... try not to burp into the microphone. We're going to head on over to Wikipedia and we are going to take a look at Sidney's Wikipedia page so you can get a little bit more context before we start listening to his music and talking about it. And as always, this is a kind of listening party stream. I won't be playing the music over the stream. That would be copyright infringement, unfortunately, but there is a link in the description so you can go and check out the album that we are going to be listening to on Spotify. You can listen to the music along with us. And when I am listening to the album, when we have the album on, give me a second, I'll bring it up. It's going to look like this at all times, so you will be able to see what track we're listening to and where in the track we are, etc. So if for whatever reason you want to come back at a later point, you'll always be able to see exactly where we are. You can catch up with us and you can listen along. Is that dog just still grumbling?
Mm-hmm.
What a little dickhead.
He's not.
He is.
Hey, Rids.
So, Sidney Joseph Bechet, born May 14th, 1897, and died May 14th, 1959. American jazz saxophonist, clarinetist, and composer. He was one of the first important soloists in jazz and first recorded several months before trumpeter Louis Armstrong. His erratic temperament hampered his career, and it wasn't until the late 40s that he gained any sort of wide acclaim. Which is interesting, right?
Mm.
Several months before Armstrong.
Well, this is this is why I like muddled up I muddle up Satchmo and Bechet a lot when I'm doing stuff like that with students. But yeah, it's one of those things where everyone remembers Satchmo, everyone remembers, you know, all the things that he did with Ella and all those songs, but some of them were really beautiful ones and really kind of useful ones, I guess, for when you're teaching or learning is definitely for Bushy.
Yeah.
Biased.
Mike comments and says, I found my channel through my Clint Strong transcriptions. Thank you very much. They're great transcriptions. I'm not complimenting my work. Let me rephrase that. They are great transcriptions of great solos. They're great solos. You can learn a lot from those. Highly recommends Louis Armstrong, My Life in New Orleans, and Mesro's Really the Blues. Both cover this harder to define era of jazz really well. Mm. And fair to describe it as that, it's very hard to define or really understand because it's so far removed from where we are now. And there's so much going on in those early years of jazz music that, yeah, you really need to do some digging and put yourself in the mindset and understand the difference between, like, I don't know, the Count Basie Orchestra mm-hmm. and Miles Davis. Like, there's a world of difference between those two things. And sure, they fall under the category, the broad category of jazz. Mm-hmm. But for any, I mean, a lot of my followers are metal fans. It's as different as trying to, you know, your parents saying, oh, yeah, no, I don't like any of that metal music. Oh, metal music, gosh. I remember, oh, no, Led Zeppelin, horrible band. Far too noisy, just far too noisy. And you're sat there listening to, I don't know, I keep saying Meshuggah because, you know, one of my favourite bands. You've got Meshuggah on and sure, there's a lineage. Like, one eventually leads to the other by decades of evolution. But you couldn't have a gig that was, you know, Meshuggah opening for Led Zeppelin. It's just they're different languages, totally different languages. And the language of this early jazz is just completely different to where jazz obviously ended up. Anyway, I'm going to carry on. So, and I'm kind of breaking my tradition here. No, I'm breaking my tradition by pointing out, because I joke on the Guitar Souls podcast that I can't read. And I constantly get flustered when I try and read on the show. And here I'm gonna be able to read, aren't I? So
there's French in there as well.
Oh dear. Bechet was born in New Orleans in 1897 to middle-class Creole of color family. His older brother, Leonard Victor Bechet, was a full-time dentist. Wow. And part-time trombonist and band leader. Bechet learned several musical instruments that were kept around the house, mostly by teaching himself. He decided to specialize in the clarinet, which he played almost exclusively until around 1919. At the age of 6, he started to perform with his brother's band at the family birthday party, debuting his talents to acclaim. Later in his youth, Bechet studied with Lorenzo Tio, Big Eye, Louis Nelson, is that Désolé?
Or Delice? I can't see that from here.
I know.
I'm old
too. Bad eyesight. And George Baquet. Is that Baquet? Or Baquet?
Bechet?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I don't know.
I haven't forgot Sidney Bechet's name.
I need some glasses.
I know Sidney Bechet's name.
I was deeply misunderstood. Like, I was like, what? Are you having a stroke? Do we need to stop?
Bechet played in many New Orleans ensembles using the improvisational techniques of the time. So obligatos with scales and arpeggios varying the melody. He performed in parades with Freddie Keppard's brass band, the Olympia Orchestra. I'm not even going to try that. Robichaud? Jean Robichaud?
Robichaud, yeah.
Yeah, we'll go with that.
As long as you say it with enough, like...
Jean Robichaud's Dance Orchestra. Is that good?
That was, yeah, sure.
Dr. Beanbag.
The Robichaud.
There we go, see. A Dr. Beanbag. From 1911 to 1912, performed with Bunk Johnson in the Eagle Band, New Orleans, blah, blah, blah. I'm just trying to get to the interesting. Because, of course, this is just going to talk about all the many people that he played with. What we're really interested in is...
Oh, I know what I'm interested in.
Go on.
He was imprisoned in Paris for 11 months. In his autobiography, he wrote that he accidentally shot a woman when he was trying to shoot a musician who had insulted him. He had challenged the man to a duel and said, Sidney Bechet never plays the wrong chord. After his release, he was deported to New York, arriving soon after the stock market crash of 1929. I always knew it was his fault. He joined Noble Sissy's Orchestra, which toured Germany and Russia. I didn't know that.
Oh, there you go. See?
I can relate to that on a cellular level, shooting people because they insulted you.
But does Melissa Kelly ever play the wrong chord?
Never.
Mm-mm. There you go. Definitely the same person. So it gives you an idea of, you know, just how early on in music his career really was. The recordings that we're going to be listening to today, we're going to be Les Années.
Yeah.
Les Années Bechet. this is a... When you look for this album, what you're going to find is it looks as though it was released in 1997. But if you dig deep into it, what you're going to find is the recording date for all of this was October 14th, 1949 to March 23rd, 1957. So it is much, much earlier than 1997 because obviously he was dead at that point. So wasn't recording it then. That would be impressive.
That'd be, I wish that were true.
I put a different spin on things. Just seeing if there's anything. Under personal life on Wikipedia, it just says, Boucher was Catholic. That's it. There's just three words there. Personal life, Boucher was Catholic.
And he was Downbeat Magazine Hall of Fame in 1968. I mean, that's kind of horrendous when you think about it. Like some of the accolades that Sidney Boucher has are quite... Not all, but there doesn't seem to be as many as I feel there should be.
Right.
Because I do genuinely believe that whilst I love Satchmo, I do think Sidney's music is something that is a little bit more spicy, a little bit more interesting. That's personal preference, obviously. So, but,
sure.
You know.
His playing style was intense and passionate, and he had a wide vibrato. He was also known to be proficient at playing several instruments, master of improvisation, both individual and collective. Shea liked to have his sound dominate in a performance, and trumpeters found it difficult to play alongside him.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Like his vibrato is, you could drive a bus through it. It's fabulous, and it's so strong. And again, as a singer trying to imitate instruments, an instrument with a huge vibrato. Yes, please, I'll try that.
Totally fair. Right. See any of our comments? Yeah, I know. See, Levi reading. But as you saw, I totally fucked it up. So. You shouldn't feel bad recommending books, Mike. You should always recommend books. You know, we learn by expanding libraries, right? And reading. So I'm all for books. You have made some good recommendations there, and I'm sure between Melissa and I, we'll pick those up because you know, we're dorks and we like to like to read about things.
Geeks.
So yeah, shall we crack on with the record and and get talking about it?
Yep.
So let me move this over here. So you can see comments coming in as they come in. Of course, guys, if you are enjoying this stream and you're learning something, please do share it with your friends. And if you are hating every second of it, then share it with your enemies.
Go fuck yourself. No.
Go subscribe to Melissa Kelly on YouTube. Melissa has a new video dropping tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
Go on, tell us more about that.
So I recently, as in the past couple of weeks, I did a session at a wonderful Glasgow-based recording studio called Venice of the North Studios. I always find that name hilarious. It makes it sound very regal. It's a lovely building. I don't know why they're trying to be sarcastic. But I did a fantastic session with a pianist, Moss Taylor, and we did our version of Aretha Franklin's Natural Woman. And I'm very proud of it. And it's I know Levi will roll his eyes and be like, "Don't, it's nothing to be impressed by." It was live in the studio, so it was one take. We were dropped in, and me and Moss didn't actually get the chance to rehearse, so we were fully. I think that was second take, wasn't it?
Used the second take. Yeah, we did four takes, I think, and used the second take. I don't roll my eyes at the idea of live recordings. It's when you brag about live recordings but don't brag about it, if you know what I mean. No, bragging's the wrong word. It's like when you release a studio album and it's essentially just a live recording and it sounds like it's a live recording, but you don't make a point of saying, you know, live, describing it as live. Because I think, you know, the rendition of on this video that you're going to hear, that people are going to hear, it's like you were there in the room with you, and which is great. But that also means that it doesn't have all the benefits of what a modern recording has in terms of being able to fix things.
Sure.
Nothing has been fixed on it. Yeah, so there's that kind of, I don't want to say compromise, but you know, let's go compromise. So I don't take issue with live recordings. I think live recordings are incredible, but when they are, you should really hammer that point home to people. So yeah, anyway, that's going to drop on Melissa's channel tomorrow, so please do go and subscribe to her channel. You will
thank you.
You'll find something you enjoy. Okay, so I'm going to bring this up. Here is the record. I am going to play Petit Fleur first, and 5.6 million plays on that one, so that's nice. I'm not sure. EC's From the Cradle. It could be many. Is that Clapton? I'm just stab in the dark. Absolutely no idea. But yeah, exactly, Drew. cool. So, as I say, when I hit play on this, you will not be able to hear anything. Link in the description. Go and line this album up on Spotify and give it a listen while we are talking to you. And to be honest, I don't think you should, you won't need to hear it, because we're going to be talking about it rather than just listening to it.
But you definitely should go and line it up and then pour like a really beautiful glass of wine or something.
Red.
Or a really tasty red wine or a really tasty whiskey, and then put it on, because it'll make you feel quite swish. Because it's Sidney Bechet, and if you're drinking and listening to Sidney Bechet, there's a class about that I enjoy. Right. I'm just trying to say it. That's all I'm trying to do.
So pick up your Ribena. Go on.
Mmm.
Your really thin red wine. Okay. So we are going to press play on this in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Enjoy. So immediately, like, really wide vibrato.
Mm.
Oh, no, I guess the thing that I didn't mention when it comes to recordings like this is, or maybe the thing that makes getting into listening to jazz difficult for people, it's recording quality for a lot of people.
Sure.
These are actually, you know, the recordings for these are actually really good, because it's 1947, was it?
Well, yeah, but the... There was a couple of live, I have a live album in the record collection that's not on Spotify, unfortunately, which is really fabulous, but the quality of the sound's a bit, ooh.
Yeah. As much as I love bebop, I really do, you know, sometimes it can be a chore listening to Parker for hours.
Yeah.
Because just all those recordings are just so bad.
Yeah.
Compared to... But actually, sometimes people give me a lot of shit for that when I describe a recording like that as bad, because they have like a sentimental attachment. That's the way they always heard the music. But mm-hmm. To people like that, I would turn around and say, did it sound like that in the room?
No.
It would sound better in the room.
Sure.
So, anyway. So, yeah, extremely wide vibrato. I mean, outrageously wide vibrato. He sounds nervous.
No, that when he's coming back down as well.
Yeah, I think when your vibrato is that wide, being a guitar player, we're always identified by vibrato. We mm-hmm. make put so much attention on vibrato. You can just immediately hear this vibrato, and just it's gonna. That's a signature right there.
Yeah.
You can't get away with that on guitar in jazz. We don't do vibrato in jazz. Here's a good example of why maybe we should.
I mean...
It's beautiful. And you mentioned European, and there's the obvious, the French sound, but we're talking, you know, New Orleans, aren't we?
But he also is phrasing. It's very much the phrasing of like a singer.
Ricardo makes a point. They're funny since instrumentalists try and imitate vocalists often.
We're all
it's the circle of life.
Yeah. We're all just trying to imitate each other.
The other thing that, Ricardo, you mentioned there with the string gauges, you find it hard to get good vibrato. I think it's more. There's more to it than that. Saxophone, clarinet, they have... There's like a natural drive to the sound, because you get all the kind of frazzle of the reed.
Mm-hmm.
The note just feels stronger. There's a bite and a body to it. The guitar sound is quite thin in comparison. It doesn't have the same sustain. We pick a note, and the loudest our note is the second you pick it.
Oh,
but whereas from there, it just decays off.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when you're playing a saxophone or a clarinet, you can start that note quiet and just get it louder. And mm-hmm. so your vibrato can really sing when you do something like this. Look at you having a wee dance.
And I just... Like, when you could literally take every melody that Sidney Bechet's playing, you could substitute it out for a singer, and it would feel the exact same way.
Sure.
It's definitely, like, I could write words to each Sydney Bechet song, knowing the sort of, I guess, the hits.
Well, there's some TikTok stuff for you.
Sure. And it would be so easy for me. The amount of times I've been asked to write things for like a session, if I've been asked to come and be the singer, oh, we've got this melody, we don't have any words for it, can you just bash up some words for it? Because of course that's exactly how easy it is, just bash up words. But they'll say to me and I'm like, sure, I can do that. And 9 times out of 10 they give me something and the melody or the phrasing they've chosen is really awkward. Or worse still, when you're writing melody and lyrics at the same time, I've dealt with a lot of musicians that are really fabulous at writing melodies, but know jack shit about phrasing.
Sure.
So they're writing things where, you know, syllables are a mess.
That vibrato is just outrageously wild, isn't it?
Yeah.
Very arpeggio based in the in the melodies. Because of course, you play the chord. In this style, you play the chord.
Yeah.
There's no like, there's a -7 chord here. Better play some melodic minor over the top of it. That would be wanky. It's like, oh, you want me to play over an A-7 chord? Cool. I'll play A, C, E, or G. And everything else that I play around that will just be a way of me dressing up those four notes.
Yeah.
And for our gaming fans out there, like this is, Bioshock, the game Bioshock, which Melissa hasn't experienced yet, so I should probably play Bioshock.
Yeah.
One of the greats, that game. Very political game.
Yeah.
I wanted to say a madman, but I guess it is a madman. But taking on like the Ayn Rand philosophy, sets up a colony for a utopia under the sea, creates a city under the sea. For everyone to go and live in and have their kind of Rand-esque utopia. Okay. And obviously everything goes to shit. Because,
of course.
Because everything goes to shit in a setting like that. So very political, but it's they left during this era.
I vaguely
remember. So everything has a real jazz vibe.
Sure. I remember you showed me.
I showed you Bioshock Infinite, which is the city in the clouds.
I just remember Quartet.
Yeah. So, if Leon is watching this, he's not watching it now, but at some point, Leon, if you are watching this and you're listening to this music, hopefully you can understand that when you listen to this, this is just a world away from Charlie Parker.
Yeah.
This is a world away from Ornette Coleman. This is a world away from Chris Potter. Or, you know, some of the more modern names that you're likely to listen to. This isn't Michael Brecker.
No.
Unfortunately, it's not Michael. No, kid. It's different, isn't it? It's just...
Yeah. I am aware of that. And it's like, I love Charles Mingus. You know, I love Charles Mingus. And some of Charles Mingus's work is sort of hard listen at times. So I'm very aware that this is... For me, this is like the gateway drug. Mingus is heroin. Sydney Bechet is like... A little bit of weed and some red wine. Do you know what I mean?
A little bit of weed and red wine, okay.
He's the gateway drug to more complex, hard to listen to jazz. I mean, the fact is, I now no longer find jazz particularly that difficult to listen to. Don't get me wrong. Stuff that you might listen to, like Michael Brecker, some of it loses me.
Sure.
Not all. Some of it I'm like, yes, please. And Mike Stern as well. It's a bit...
That's bringing in way too much rock for you, though.
Yeah.
That actually has a lot of element. You know, I mentioned it before, not listening to modal music. Actually, Mike Stern, most of his music is modal music. So for anyone listening to this now, what you're hearing here is just wonderful examples of functional harmony. If you just put the melody aside and just listen to the chord progression, you have something that the progression itself almost gives you a melody. You just want to sing... melodies over the top of this.
And I think that's also what I kind of like about it, because I remember when I first listened to Sydney Bechet and I was following what he was doing, and then at times I would put it on and I would just sing along with it. Sydney Bechet leaves space, and I think that's something that it gets lost a bit the further you go on in jazz. Space becomes... doesn't happen. There's no space. The space is filled with everybody. Whereas in this stuff, there's tons of space.
Yeah.
that can easily be filled with more melody. That.
Oh, look, Leon Barron is online. How's it going, Leon?
Hi, Leon.
There's minor six chords.
Are you starting to see a little bit of why I am the way I am?
No, I know exactly why you are the way you are. Those minor six chords in there, they are just instant European jazz. I mean, it's flawless. You mm-hmm. can't, this cannot be criticized.
No.
Because it's just extremely melodic playing. It doesn't really leave much to be desired. Although, like, I came up in jazz in a post-Parker world.
Mm-hmm.
So I want those flurries of, mm-hmm. of long eighth note runs and 16th note double time runs, etc. Sure. This doesn't need them.
No. I think the other thing that's it's going to be exciting as the album goes on is when Boucher does stuff that is of a slightly darker nature, because definitely a lot of the jazz that was around at this point, it was to be performed to people. It was, like you say, it was dirty jazz. It was to be brought in for the kids to listen to something new and exciting. So a lot of it is far more, I guess, cozy is a good word to use for it, or music that you expect to be played in the background of Bioshock or American Horror Story as a yeah. sort of counterpoint to some of the horrifying things that are going on. But when Sidney Bechet is given something that is a bit darker, a bit chewier, what he does with it is particularly delicious. There's a lot of, I mean, I don't even pretend to know everything about modes and all that kind of stuff, but when it's leaning more towards a sort of Phrygian feel, it's some of the stuff he does with it is stunning. Hmm. Stunning.
HK says, it really is amazing how much is about the joy of breathing itself. It's what a voice essentially is.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. He's I'm sure he's breathing circularly, but he's also having to think about the economics. We were talking about this earlier on, the economics of his breathing. So he can probably hear what it is that he wants to I'm going to say sing. He's probably going to hear what he wants to sing next, but he has to then anticipate the amount of air that he needs to get to the end of that phrase.
Yeah.
And even when you're improvising, you're still thinking constantly, right, what's the kind of phrase I want to aim for? How much breath am I going to need for that? And when you listen to Sidney Bechet, even on the live stuff, which is clearly a little bit more improvised, the spaces where he's breathing are perfect. He's chosen them so perfectly. And when he's getting to the end of his lines and he is starting to get to the end of a breath, sometimes he leaves it deliberately too long so that when he does get to the end of the breath and you get to that point where your voice is about to go, the clarinet just quietly fades out. It's like he's fading himself out. It's so beautiful.
So something that on the breath side of things that makes this sound extremely human, I heard him play two notes. He's done it many times, but if we just go ba-da, if I do that on the guitar, I'm going to play ba-ba-ba. And there's no nuance between those two notes. Mm-hmm. Whereas in this, because it's an instrument that is powered by the lungs, you can sing your first note, ba, and you can really move into that second note and dip in volume and then bring that volume back up, which again, it's a breath control thing, and it just makes everything sound so human. It's something you can relate to. What I would be interested in on this next track, if you would be willing to, how do you feel about singing some stuff?
Yeah, that's fine.
If he plays any melodies that you think are like just a little beautiful melody, just imitate it. Just so we can get a feel for things that.
Just make Levi do it. So that's what everyone does though when they imitate a trumpet. They go, but with like clarinet, it's because it's the rounder sound, I always want to go to the side of my mouth a little bit. A bit Popeye. I always want to go to the side of my mouth. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- Nice. Yeah, I've not done it for years and years, but it's
funny because when you do that, I can immediately imagine you having done that for hours long to stuff like this.
Hours and hours and hours and hours. Like when Satuvi and Mamir comes on, I'm not kidding. That's like, and which is why I'm gonna go home, go out of the studio and shoot myself later. That I did La Vie en Rose instead of Satuvi and Mamir, but it's because I was talking about Satchmo and I got stuck in my brain.
Sure.
But it was that, and it was.
Hello, Dylan.
Hi, Dylan. Copyright strike incoming. I think as well, it wasn't even just jazz that Sidney Bechet taught me about. It was phrasing.
And TGS here says, today I had an audition to study jazz guitar at the conservatory.
Oh.
What am I doing with my life? Oh. Well, you're wasting it. No, I kid.
No!
I'm totally, totally kid. But what you learn, the more you explore jazz guitar, is just how lacking it is as an instrument.
Yeah.
Now, don't get me wrong, I love it. I'm going to just sing Pat Martino's praises till I die because he's just incredible. But, you know, Pat Martino plays a lot of notes because, again, he has to.
Yeah.
You play a note on the guitar and it's dead after a few seconds. So it's just dead. To. Whereas this, you
can kind of let it soar a little bit, which is not necessarily, I think, something you can do with a guitar.
Yeah. And that's frustrating because, you know, when I listen to this, I can learn things about phrasing.
Yeah.
How somebody phrases with their breath.
Yeah.
But it doesn't make it easy for me to then imitate that on the guitar because the guitar is lacking that thing, the breath thing.
I never really thought about it like that before.
Hmm. And I've got the same problem now playing piano. Still the same idea, right? I've got probably a little bit more sustain.
Mm-hmm.
I've got more control over dynamics and things. But still, that ability to play a note on the piano. There's a meme that I see all the time just recently. Say, if you ever want to piss a piano player off, just ask them to play this. And it's a note with a hairpin on it. So play it and make the note get louder as you play it. Like a pianist can't do that. Or ask them to do a bend or anything like that. Like that's frustrating when you play the piano. But you don't have it when you play the clarinet.
Mm-hmm. I mean, all of this is really beautiful. I can't wait for it to get to summertime. And I know summertime is one of those, you know, standard jazz musicians that's entirely overplayed and oversang. But, you know.
For good reason.
Absolutely. Yeah. And if it's the same kind of version that I remember, it's, again, I think my favourite version of Summertime that I ever heard was by Mahalia Jackson. She's a gospel singer. And she sung it like it was classical, a mixture of like classical music and gospel.
Right.
So half opera, half gospel. She's fabulous at it. But she was doing it with a bunch of jazz musicians. And I think when I listen to Sidney Bechet do Summertime and other musicians like him, it's that mix of all that European influence in the music that makes it something that's a little bit more intricate. And I think with the way that jazz is, especially sort of like very American jazz, and the way it's leaked out into all of our popular music that we listen to, you know, you can get really commercial poppy singers that can do a version of Summertime that is very sort of very well sang and very sort of, and maybe a little bit spicy, but altogether very predictable. I love when very European-based musicians do very standard sort of American feel jazz songs.
Dylan says, I like jazz, but I have to admit that I've never really liked jazz guitar all that much. And I understand. I do understand. Like I keep mentioning the bebop thing, which is really the thing that got me into jazz. There's no real bop guitar players in that era, you know, in the actual authentic era. The guitar, if you look at the history of the guitar in a jazz setting like this, you're more likely to hear a tenor banjo or tenor guitar.
Tenor banjo.
Originally, if you go back into like Duke Ellington, Count Basie era, it would have been a tenor banjo that would be doing the guitar, that chunk rhythm thing, which then became tenor guitar.
Yeah.
And then that moved over to six string guitar. That's our role in a setting like this, is to go chitung, chitung, chitung. We're a rhythm instrument. We play a little bit of harmony, but it's not until Charlie Christian that we become a soloing instrument.
It totally is the same one. Yeah. It's so weird, but I love it. Because it's dark and it's scary. I love when you go...
Yeah, that's the improvisational side of things, right? Go on. Keep it going. Notes starting out quiet, getting louder.
I can't do it as fast as him. Before he goes into the more major feel. Letting it go until there's nothing left.
Sorry.
My favorite Boucher.
An infinitely more, not infinitely more expressive than guitar. It's massively more expressive than guitar, but infinitely more expressive than the piano.
Mm.
You can't do this on the piano.
No.
Damn it! I learned the wrong instrument.
Yes, you did. Oh, I see.
Yeah. Never really losing sight of that melody.
No.
At any time, if you were singing the words along to this, it would still make sense.
Yeah. In fact, you could actually sing along with this, and whilst it would be a bit more messy than or muddy than the summertime should be, but it wouldn't feel like what Sidney Bechet was playing was anything other than complimenting. Check you and your bad self.
You better work, Ellie. You better work, Max.
You better work, Brover.
He's like, I'm not working, I'm sleeping. Glad I'm teaching you the wrong instrument, Leon. Of course, you know, I joke like that, but like, I love the fact that I play guitar and I love the fact that I'm playing piano now. What you can take from both of those instruments is that I have a fascination with harmony. I have a fascination with chords and how notes interact with each other.
Yeah.
And every instrument has its strengths. Every instrument has its weaknesses. It would be entirely possible to learn to play clarinet or saxophone and never really have a deep understanding of chords and harmony in the same way that I do. You can't support other musicians as a clarinet player. So.
This is going into more to like Harry Belafonte, Calypso style music now.
Dance whore.
What's this? Have you got like...
I've got no rhythm, you know this.
Levi Clay, you're the only man I've ever met that is so very talented at what you do. But I'm no fucking rhythm.
After releasing several educational books, plot twist is Levi learned the wrong instrument.
But then again, Calypso music and Harry Belafonte and all that, that was, you know, heavily influenced by a lot of European style music as well. Michael Felix Brecker.
See, I love Michael Brecker so much, my dog is named Michael Felix Brecker.
Michael.
And for anyone keeping score, Michael Brecker's middle name wasn't actually Felix.
No.
Okay, son?
Michael.
He's just angry because he can't hear the jazz.
He's like, what are you bitches so happy about?
What's all this?
That was a stinker. And now people are just, everyone's left the chat. Yeah. Everyone's gone. This is, do you know what essentially is going on right here? This is you and you're an old man just holding a dog and singing to the calypso in your brain.
Yeah, the Claybys are back.
Claybys? Aww. That's a nice name for you, Michael. Beep, 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 beep.
Is that you, Sam? Are you getting down now?
You had enough?
No, he doesn't want to. You did arrive at a weird time. If you could start imitating some more.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Okay, yeah, this is me just.
And but the same thing is still true. That's useful to people, I think, because Leon's got this on in the background and he's not listening to the actual music. And I know Peter isn't listening to the music either. So you are, Melissa wins. Yeah, oh, I know.
You're a trumpet, I'm a clarinet.
Yeah. You're class, I'm an ass. That's the difference. Yeah. I think that when people hear you singing along, though, even if they can't hear the music, it's inherently musical.
Yeah.
Everything you're doing has logic, a structure to it. It sounds relatable. You can paint the picture. Whereas I think a lot of people think about, when they think about jazz, they think of these long flowing lines that you could sing on your own that you'd need a degree in music to really understand what was going on.
Yeah.
If you sing the solo to Giant Steps. People are going to get lost with it, right?
Yeah.
Whereas everything you sang there felt like something you would sing.
You can almost hear the harmony in the background. Yeah. It's not like, sometimes I sometimes sing Goodbye Poor Pie Hat or Moaning, and there's not always, if you don't know it, it's not always, it doesn't feel like you can hear a harmony underneath it unless you know it well. I mean, buckle up, Barbara, because Satuvu My Mare is coming, and that is one of my favourite Sidney Bechet's.
Yes, Colin Studios, there is a link in the description to where you could be listening along with us.
Yay! Colin's like, Melissa and Levi have went off the rails. They're just freebasing cocaine in the studio with a dog.
What it is, mate, is respecting copyright, and I'm just such a, I'm a stickler for it. I just always want to, I could, it would be as easy as this, look. Now everybody can hear the music. And now they can't. It just wouldn't feel right to stream the music.
Yeah.
Which is a shame, because the videos would be much more popular if I did. That, the percussion in the back of that, and I'm calling it percussion because I don't want to say
banjo.
Drums. That, no, I mean, it sounds like someone with a pot and pan.
But then that's, I feel like that's a New Orleans thing
absolutely.
Well. I love that dead stop right there. Definitely, like, some of the stuff that inspired me when I was thinking about arrangements was that sort of pure white hot chaos of New Orleans jazz sometimes. Because if it doesn't go, it goes between something like this that's very jammy and it's clear that everyone's in the room and having a good old time to themselves. But then there's also the ones that are like, you know, funeral marches and stuff where everyone knows the melody, they know what's going on, they know the harmony, but they're just playing whatever the hell they want over each other, and I love that.
TGS is singing along too.
Wee wee boo wee boo boop doop doop doop.
I mean, you're gonna do great studying jazz at a conservatoire, man. Yeah, beautiful melodies.
That's obviously an older one because it does the sort of quality of the recordings feels a bit more crunchy.
Not necessarily meaning that it's an older recording. It's a bigger group.
Sure.
So that just back then there would be no way to have an individual mic on every single mm-hmm. instrument. Whereas if you put him in a quintet setting, it's much, much more easier to more cleanly record each instrument.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about Satuvia Mamir.
Okay.
Because that's the next track that's coming up. So if you want to join in now, this is a good time to do it. Satuvia Mamir is the slow version. I haven't heard the slow version for a while, actually, but it's, again, still one of my favourites. I think the thing I love about Satuvia Mamir is the intervals in it and all the melody that he plays throughout. They jump so hugely. And it's one of those
songs... For clarification, are you going to be singing along?
I'm not shy. But his intervals jump quite a lot, and there is the motif, the main section of the song that he returns to all the time. But he hints at everything else around it. Oh, here it comes.
Lovely vibrato, yeah. Charlie Parker, this is not.
Motif.
Beautiful melody, right? It hurts me that I don't just have the music playing over this with you singing, because it's beautiful. I'm Here's getting a real motif. Treat here.
To the original motif.
You enjoy yourself?
Yeah, I love that song so much. It makes me so happy.
Get some comments in.
yeah, Leon, it's in Midnight in Paris. That is such a great film. It really is. It's it is Woody Allen. I mean, he's a problematic figure, but it's a great film. And it's one of those wonderful films where nothing actually really extravagant happens. It just moseys along.
Okay, you just got a tip.
Oh, did I? Oh, thank you.
HK also left you a comment before Leon's comment.
What was that? HK, you mentioned Mahalia Jackson, her version of Amazing Grace. HK, I'm not kidding. Mahalia Jackson's another one. I imitated her so much when I was trying to learn about gospel music, because I think when it comes to gospel, a lot of people go to the sort of more mainstream commercial ideas of gospel. So they're looking at things like Aretha Franklin and singers like her. But Mahalia Jackson was one that was introduced to me by a wonderful blues guitarist in Glasgow called Al Brown. Al Brown talked to me about Mahalia Jackson, and I went away and I listened to everything. She's just this beautiful mix of classical and gospel. So good.
Nothing says how much you love the thing that you're hearing than when you just turned to me, reached over and grabbed my arm to sing the melody. That's what you're looking for, I think, with something like this. You want melodies that just make you grab someone.
Yeah.
Like, check this out.
Satuvia Mamir, everyone should listen to it. It's such a beautiful, it's the most beautiful example of jazz being something that's so wonderfully easy to connect with.
And Leon making that connection with this being the tune in Midnight in Paris, like, yeah, there's an entire era of jazz, if you like, that you'd think of as music from films.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was just, It wasn't jazz. It was pop music.
Yeah. This is stunning.
So Peter says that you could write a really good screenplay listening to this stuff.
Yes, you could. A really like wonderful, smoky, noir, like Casablanca. So one of the things that I watch as well, when like you do, there's not getting videos of very very old brass players is quite difficult, but watching some of the sort of 1969 back the way, if you can get hold of videos of you know, trumpet players, saxophonists and clarinetists, or clarinet players. The one thing that I always tend to watch as well as a vocalist is their support. So basically what I mean by their support is just, you know, how they're engaging their diaphragm in order to do what they do. I cannot breathe circularly. It's not something that I've ever been able to wrap my head around.
I practiced it.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
It's so difficult. It's so difficult. But one of the things I watch them doing is engaging their diaphragm, and if they're engaging the support underneath their lungs in order to hold some of this breath that they do, and it's fascinating.
It's fascinating because it's deceptive what the circular breathing motion is.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really an exhaling whilst inhaling. Yeah. It's storing air in your mouth, pushing that air out whilst refilling your lungs, and having the control to do the two at the same time.
That is insane to me. One of the things that I teach my vocal students is to never top up. If you've got like a really long amount of very high in your range lines coming up, phrases coming up, worst thing you can do is completely empty your lungs before that begins and continue to empty your lungs completely and go from zero. So we do talk about when we are doing a succession of really hard phrases to store that, take the deep, deep supported breath, and instead of letting it go, holding on to bits of it so that you're just topping up the tank instead of going from zero. That's difficult enough without storing air in your mouth.
But it's when I say that, I mean like if you puff your cheeks out and go, and then if you slowly go, when you do that, there's nothing coming from your lungs, right?
Yeah.
That's you just sort of squeezing the cheeks in, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can do that and go.
Oh, I guess, yeah.
You can inhale while you're doing that. So you would be inhaling when you push out.
Okay.
Spray everywhere. Juice in my moustache. You would be pushing the air out while inhaling. Mm-hmm. And then by the time you've emptied your mouth of, you've filled your lungs in order to top your mouth up again.
Yeah, that's fascinating.
Or at least those are the beginner exercises.
Sure.
Got a little bit carried away there. Sidetracked. Giving you tips on how to do something I don't do. Or I can't do.
So this is one of these ones that's that New Orleans Rammy. At points of this song, every instrument that's there, or at least some of the more lead instruments, are just playing whatever they want melody-wise over the top. And I love it. Chaos. Pure chaos. Like, everyone's just like, it's my time to shine.
But the thing you're doing there is really important, which is...
Yeah.
The click on the 2 and 4. Yeah. Like, that heavy accent on the 2 and 4, you really want to... It's an important part of hearing this and getting this style down.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, of course, if we flip it...
Yeah.
Friends don't learn, friends clap on 1 and 3.
If you clap on 1 and 3, well, all I'm saying is maybe you should try sterilisation. I'm kidding.
My legs are on fire.
Shut my whore mouth. You know what I mean?
Sure. It just makes you an uneducated swine.
So that's your trumpet there. That's you there. You gotta do the.
Why do I do this? What's wrong with me?
I'm not sure. Lots of things.
This is why the only friends I have are the ones behind computer screens.
who can turn you off or mute you at any point. Yeah.
Yeah, so the, as a genre, as a sound, as a vibe, these recordings that we've been listening to, I just can't ever see you being exhausted with this. You know what I mean? You could just put this on and have this on, even just in the background, for hours and hours, and never really be like, oh, I'm tired of this now.
Yeah.
And you can get that with bebop.
Yeah, I think that's... oh, I love this song so much. It's that wonderful, it's the same thing as Nina Simone, I think. Nina Simone is one of those singers, much like Billie Holiday, much like Ella Fitzgerald, I guess, one of those singers that you could put on in the background and hum along to and have it on for literally hours and it not feel like you need a lie down or a nap afterwards. Or that becomes irritating if you're doing something complex. You know, sometimes you might leave jazz on and then it gets into some really heavy jazz and some quite complex stuff and you start doing something really important or frustrating and you're like, oh, I need to turn this down. Or in the car, I'm lost, I need to turn this down. It's not that kind of music. And September Song is also a fabulous one. I think it's September Song and Sidney Poitier reminds me of when you guys were talking about earlier about jazz guitarists, something that I'd never really listened to, which is a bold thing to say when my boyfriend is a guitarist. All guitarists are trash is what I'm saying. No, I'm kidding.
Hey, when I met you, I started to learn to play the piano so you wouldn't hate me.
You didn't. You learned to play the guitar, the piano just to chat me up. That was basically it.
I should actually just throw that out whilst you guys are all here. I'm just going to go keep talking.
So, yeah, one of the things that Levi introduced me to was jazz guitarists. And I feel like I find some of them really, really hard to connect with. But Pat Martino, when he's doing stuff like Send in the Clowns from the album...
We'll Be Together Again.
Oh, my Lord. It's got the same Sidney Bechet feel about it. It's all really, really beautiful phrasing. The phrasing is beautiful on it. It's a recurrent melody, motif in the song of obviously Send in the Clowns. But he explores outside of that bit. But he always brings you back to the melody that you know, and it's glorious.
I've just posted a link in the description to pianote.com/Levi Clay. If you are watching the stream and you would like to help support the channel, you can go and get a free trial at pianote.com, a completely free trial, a 30-day free trial using my link. And I will get paid by Pianote for you just signing up for a free trial. So you can get a free trial and cancel it tomorrow and I'll still get paid. So it's a great, great way to support the channel. $20 they put in my pocket for that. That's a lot of money for a free trial.
I can always remind you. I can always remind you to cancel. I don't know how I'd do that. Oh.
Well, so you can make mention. You've made mention a few times of this having a European edge to it, and it does have a slight European edge to it. But to me, it's like an offshoot of that. Europeans that moved to New Orleans sound.
Yeah.
It's not full-on European because when I said I associate saxophone with American jazz and clarinet with European jazz, there are other things that I associate with American jazz and there are other things I associate with European jazz. So I said saxophone, but I also associate trumpet with American jazz. I also associate trombone with American jazz. When I think of European jazz, I think of clarinets. I think of violins.
I think of like Stefan Grappelli and Django.
And you think of accordions.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, accordions. My only issue with accordions is that, like, I feel like some of them, the recordings of them just make them sound like, I don't know, they've been recorded in a wind tunnel and then mixed in a biscuit tin. And I just.
HK, when you say you inspired you to go and learn your song, I assume you mean the Elton John, your song? Maybe the thing that's going to kind of not disappoint people, but disappoint still feels like it's a wrong mindset would be the way to describe it. So if you, I imagine most people that follow my channel are pretty proficient guitar players, reasonably proficient guitar players. There is nothing that we've heard today that you couldn't play. You know, there's nothing note-wise, from a guitar player's perspective, because we deal in just playing the damn notes.
Sure.
To get the expression, that's a lifetime of work, but we've already established we can't get that expression on the guitar. So you might find that a lot of people would listen to something like this. Like I would have initially when I started listening to jazz. The thing that grabbed me was, it was Giant Steps. I'm not going to pretend it wasn't. A saxophonist friend of mine gave me a copy of Giant Steps and was like, go and check this out. You're into the shred stuff. I'm sure you'll really like this. And I did, because it was chopsy. Yeah. If I'd listened to this, I would have gone, like, come on, fucking do something.
Yeah.
It requires a maturity to realize how dumb that is. Yeah.
Well, it's also just like one of the things that I think I've come up against again and again when I've been working with all kinds of different instrumentalists, but I have to say, more guilty are the guitarists, is not knowing when not to play and not knowing exactly the right amount of sprinkling of ornamentation onto a full band performance of something to make it something really engaging and something people want to connect with. And I think whilst, yes, some of the expression on this is going to be impossible for a guitarist, I do still think it's a wonderful representation of playing to a song rather than just playing to yourself. I mean, you could obviously argue with some of the things we've talked about, Bashir, is he was a bit of a megalomaniac who demanded that he be the loudest, most important instrument in the room. I can relate.
Rightfully so.
Yeah. But yeah, there's something else in there. I feel like if you listen to Sidney Bechet and the stuff that he did, I mean, as I said, definitely some of the things that people want to go and listen to are the album, the album series. There's 6 volumes, I think, of it's called Jazz Nocturne, and there's some more. There's way more spicy things in there. Stuff that he wasn't going to be necessarily playing to big crowds of young people to try and get them to dance. It was definitely more of a jazz expression. Yeah, if you can listen to it and not find something in there that you can use to imitate or to try and understand better how to be a musician, then good lord.
There's a comment here about it may sound cliched, but A Love Supreme is what I still adore, the Coltrane album. And for me, A Love Supreme is Coltrane in modal jazz land, and it doesn't do it for me.
I mean, I'm always gonna lean more towards the blues end of jazz, so and the older, I love older Miles. I can't fuck with when he's getting more and more.
Don't tell me you don't love Bitches Brew. Who doesn't love Bitches Brew? But I actually don't love Bitches Brew.
I do. Well, parts of it.
What you want is Miles Davis when Mike Stern was in the band.
Sure. God bless Mike Stern. I just, sometimes I'm into it and then a lot of other times I'm not.
The thing with Mike, maybe I'll tell you exactly what we're going to do. After we finish this stream, we're going to go into the house and I'm going to get out a Mike Stern Blu-ray. The thing with Mike is you have to watch Mike play.
But I've watched him play before.
Where?
You've shown me videos plenty.
No.
Yeah.
No. Not proper. Yes, not proper. Mike's a personality. He's the happiest man in the world.
I'm sure. But he can go ahead and be happy. That doesn't mean I have to connect with his music. And I do on occasion.
Tension resolution.
I guess the other thing you need to remember about when you're listening to Bashir is he was doing this stuff in what, the 40s? The early 40s?
He would have been doing it before that as well.
So it's like,
he didn't receive critical acclaim until the 40s.
But you know, while some of you might go and listen to this and go, well, you know, there's nothing here that I can't do, and da 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 da. It's like, sure, but just appreciate the fact that before anyone knew what was going on, Sidney Bechet was doing this. Before Louis Armstrong.
I think that is what's best about it. It's the because he's not pushing any serious technical boundaries. Everything he plays, he can execute with such a supreme level of control and confidence. All of the effort goes into the quality of the note, making the note sound as good as you can.
Oh, the piano in the background of this actually is stunning.
Give me 6 months.
Fair enough. A beautiful.
Something magical about a unison line like that that bursts out into a question. No, it's not a question and answer. It's two people going mad.
Yeah.
Ah, okay, I see, Peter. As tu le cafard. What does that mean?
Et tu. I mean, it says slow fox next to it, so I'm just going to go, maybe it's something to do with foxes. That big jump. Do you have the blues?
Do you have the blues? I love Art Tatum. I love Art Tatum's playing. I've got a really great piano book on. It's literally just called. Is it the right hand or left hand? The right hand, according to Art Tatum, and it's a big thick book on. Every, you know, his entire style and his approach to the way his right hand played. Art Tatum is a fascinating player because it's the opposite of this. Art Tatum was trying to push as many technical boundaries as he possibly could, and it sounds like fucking chaos sometimes. Like he's playing way faster than he should, but you still know what he's going for, and there's an attitude to that, and I really like that. You listen to much Art Tatum?
No.
Well, I'll put some Art Tatum on after this.
I was very much down the route of Charles Mingus, Thelonious Monk, John Coltrane sometimes, not a lot of. Alison Coltrane, woo!
But when you look at, so time-wise, Tatum's way before that. He died in 56. Mm-hmm. Recording career started in 33. So super early, like 30s.
Oh, I've definitely heard Art Tatum's stuff. It's not something that I grab onto. This feels like a strange song to finish this album on. I feel like September Song or Satuvu Mamer should have finished it.
Yeah, I have to say, like from my perspective, these kind of, would you be okay calling these New Orleans jam type vibe things, bigger bands? I don't like these nearly as much as him playing a very lyrical, a ballad type thing.
There is a, like I say, there's an album I've got inside that's, it's on record. I can't get it on Spotify, but I'm sure you'll be able to get it someplace else. It's Sidney Bechet live in, I think he was in Bruges in 1966. That album right there, because I think at that point, I'm not even sure now if it was 66. I'm getting myself confused, but just type in 1966 live in Bruges and it might be 1966, but it's very dark. It's incredibly dark.
After this, I'm going to play some music over the stream, confident I won't get a copyright strike.
Okay.
I'm going to put on I Won't Give Up On You.
Oh, okay, sure. I give you permission, does that matter? No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, honestly. So my takeaway from this and listening to you sing all these melodies,
yeah.
There's an instant, like, I get it. I get the connection. It sounds really, really beautiful. I know if I was sat here with my guitar and I was listening to it and then copying the things that are being played, it would nowhere near as satisfying.
Yeah.
And there we go. Les années bêchées. I'm just going to jump over just for a comparison. What?
Oh, who's this bitch?
So if we, again, plug Melissa Kelly, because she kindly donates her time to sit in on these things. If we compare that New Orleans jam sound to the song I Won't Give Up On You off of Melissa's album Devil's Luck, you'll immediately get the...
Yeah, it's I'm robbing the grave of Sydney Boucher. Yeah.
I'll just put some Tatum on for you while we're before we head out. Yeah, why not?
So pretty. 2:40. You better behave yourself, Art Tatum. Okay, there's a part in Harry Connick Jr.'s big band performance in New York in 1994 when there's a part of Kiss Me and I'll da da ba 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 da da, kiss me, lovely listen to da da da. And he goes into this like really jangly, really quick thing, and I've just realised it's Art Tatum he's pretended to be.
Yeah.
And I've been listening to that concert since I was 7.
yeah, so Art Tatum, absolutely, you know, great player. Like, we'd love to be able to play like that, but that's never happening.
Don't be so negative.
I'll keep practicing. I'll keep practicing. And you guys can keep practicing by heading over to piano.com/LibreClaims. Signing up for a free trial at piano. I mean, I don't know why Peter was considering signing up for a free trial at piano. Peter, can you send me an Instagram video or message or audio recording or something of you playing piano so I can play it for Melissa? So Melissa can hear how good you are on piano. Yeah, freak. Yeah, big freaky 16 or 17 year old freak you.
Don't tell me you're young and really talented.
Certainly not old enough to drink, put it that way.
I mean,
also wrote the original Guitar Souls fan fiction.
Oh, no, wait. No, I remember now. I remember who you are. Yeah. That's fabulous.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm going to run my credits.
and get out of this awkward conversation.
Wrong button. Thank you very much for tuning in, guys. If you would like to support the channel, best way to do that is head on over to Patreon, link in the description, and support the channel for as little as $1. It all helps. Honestly, every little fucking helps. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's all appreciated. So you want to be like these awesome people, get access to my private patron-only Facebook group where you can engage with us even more. Me and Melissa are going to be doing a lot more of these. Mm-hmm. And we are going to be talking about jazz, and we are going to be launching our podcast,
yes.
Does Metal Have Soul? Mm-hmm. You guys are not going to want to miss it. It's going to be great fun. And yeah, there'll be lots and lots of... there'll be lots and lots of stuff covered. Alternatively, you can head on over to Amazon, check out one of my books, and yeah, they keep the lights on. So anything you would like to say, Melissa?
Please,
Kelly.
Kelly, please head over. I have my own YouTube channel. It's a wee place where I sometimes pop up music, and tomorrow I'll be popping up my performance of Natural Woman by Aretha Franklin with me and a wonderful pianist from Glasgow called Moss Taylor. So do head over there and subscribe for me. I also have a Patreon if you're interested in hearing more about singing and songwriting. I mean, Levi's just shaking his head. He can go fuck himself. But yeah, I'm really looking forward to the podcast. But what I'm also very much looking forward to is if all of you, and I've said this every time, and not enough of you do it, which means I'm coming for all of you. I'm going to find out where you live. You need to tell Levi that we have to do a stream of a Tom Waits album. I won't say it again, but I will say it again.
Every part of me was just going to click stop streaming there, just cut you off mid-sentence.
No!
I've told you that's absolutely going to happen, but that will be on. That'll be a Patreon exclusive.
God damn it.
What's wrong with that?
No, that's fair.
Yeah. So, you know, people don't want too many of these things.
But thank you so much, and thank you very much, HK, for putting a wee tip on there. That was really sweet. Thank you so much. Yay!
Sweet. Much love, guys, and we will see you for another stream at some point in the future. Bye. Goodbye.
Bye
now. Goodbye. Goodbye. Bye. Goodbye now. Bye.